I've pretty much learned, I've been taught very well about how not to trust other people. And what I need to learn more about is trusting other people and trusting myself. And that's what that has been my journey with this. Part was when I was basically, you know, and I figured when I got back to Bellingham, I realized that all my friendships were the exact same way. Like another friend I had, she was like, well, I don't want you to come on this trip with me because I'm worried you don't have enough money. And this is a really important trip and I don't want to spend it with you. I'm bringing my other friend instead of you. And that's when I knew, I was like, oh my gosh, like when she said that, the conversation that the this other guy had told me kind of just echoed in my head. It's like, well, and it was like literally the exact conversation. I am about to go into adulthood and I want to be around other people right now. And then I'm going to be going into adulthood. And the inference of that is that I'm not bringing you with me. Because I don't really consider you an adult. And I was like, wow. I was like, okay, well, I'll give you gas money. Like, I offered to give her gas money. I ended up just going by myself later. Because my friend was up there and she had gone through some things. I wanted to see her. And I needed, you know, some positivity, some fun in my life after my mom lied to me about me in one-way ticket and basically removed me from my home and my bed and my dog. And my ex refused to send me my dog, and I developed a real complex. Like, I was like, well, maybe I'm just not a good mom. I let people influence me a little too much, I think, at that time. I let them bring me down. It was hard not to be brought down, I mean, by something like that, to be honest. I mean, it's amazing the level of betrayal that was involved. I had a really hard time thinking about myself in terms of being a mother, and I threw myself into my career. And I didn't plan on having any children. Because I let people tell me, like, I'm crazy and incapable and I'm not a good mom. And that's not true, because I'm a really fucking good mom. I'm really nurturing, I'm really loving. If you're not a little crazy in this world, there's something wrong with you. You're a freaking automaton. You're a freaking zombie. And you're not aware of what's going on. And you are asleep, quite frankly. We're in a mass extinction. A pandemic. We have people who... millennial, like, younger generations... are... you know, struggling even worse than my generation was with the economy, which I didn't think was possible, but, you know. This has been a journey for me, and when I got to be, like, older, I had a few miscarriages. I don't think that affected me that much, I think it was more what affected me was the mother wound, the feeling of having my child taken from me after, like, a pregnancy that I couldn't keep, which was my dog. I couldn't keep the baby, and I had the dog, and then my dog was taken, and it was really, really, really hard. And I didn't really know, like, how to cope with that. I eventually did get therapy when I was at welding school, like, a few years later, which I find, like, amazing. Like, I went through all this without help. And, like, I remember, like, I talked to people, and I got help from people I shouldn't have gotten help from and should never spoken to again. I helped people, and stayed friends with people that I should have never spoken to again. Boundaries. Like, you know, that was the lesson, you know. So you know, just the horrificness of actually having someone take your money because they're so upset about a broken down car, and they were upset about having to pay a bill for a dog that they supposedly co-owned and were making the final decision on her ownership. However, they were angry about having to pay one expense out of all the expenses the dog had over almost 3 years, two, three years, I paid for the vet bills. I remember being at the vet with him and handing the card over and thinking, I wonder if he's going to pay for it like a real man would. He never did. I paid for it. It's fine. It was my dog. But you know, at the end, it wasn't my dog anymore. Somehow my ownership was not even part of that anymore. Because you know why? Because I didn't exist to that person. I was just a fantasy that was going to launch him into adulthood, and I was going to be discarded. I could feel the discard as soon as he hit the ground in the city. And I even had the feeling in my mind, he's looking for someone else, someone new and exciting. You know, it was an exciting city that we were in. There were a lot of, you know, cool young people, and I felt it was perfectly natural for him to want to date other people and be in an exciting new city and meet new people at that age. I felt it was perfectly natural, and I was trying to facilitate us, like, breaking up and be friends and do it the right way and not fucking kill each other and hate each other and try to, like, brutalize each other. But, like, that's not how some people operate. So protect yourself. I know, so I always tell people, like, my friend, she's, like, dating a guy. He's like, oh, he's already talking about getting his name on the deed. You just met him. Wait a little while. You don't know people very well. You don't know what they're capable of when they're under stress. And they're capable of a fucking whole hell of a lot, let me tell you. They will extort you for money. Manipulate you emotionally to steal money that they feel they were owed. And then steal your dog. And then they'll go and get themselves a dog. Mm-hmm. A new dog. Yeah. So this was kind of my experience, and it did kind of damage me in terms of, like, wanting to be a mom. And I have been dealing, I didn't really realize, you know, how much it would happen, and could not know until I got into my age now, which I'm 38. You just can't know. You just can't. And, the deep fear of even wanting a child is paralyzing, to be honest, for fear of losing it or having my child taken from me. Because the situation and those choices that were made on both sides, I honestly didn't, I'm really lucky that I survived it. I am. I screamed in my sleep. I had horrible nightmares for over a year. I actually even had to stay at the house of the girl that I'm pretty sure he cheated on me with when we were in Idaho. I was, like, talking to this chick, and, like, going to the club and whatnot. You know, it's just, the extent of grossness was severe. It was a lot of cognitive dissonance and a lot of compartmentalization to kind of get through that part of my life and survive and get the fuck out of Dodge, which I did. I left the city. As soon as I got there, I pretty much left, and I was a changed woman. I was completely different. I was never going to be the same. You know, I got into relationships. I had someone, like, call me a bitch once. I fucking moved out. I packed all my shit, and I never came back. Like, I'm cool. Like, I'm good. I don't need it. And now I'm going through the journey of getting more pets. Like, I adopted more animals. I was always like kind of like way too stringent. I only had one cat over the years. I didn't believe at the time that for a long time that you should leave a dog home all day, which I don't think you should. As a puppy, it's really not a good idea. And I stayed home with my new puppy, and it's a Rottweiler in my house. I don't get anything chewed up. I don't, because I'm there training it. He does everything, like, because I'm there. So I had a different philosophy about teaching and how involvement should work in relationships, in mothering and stuff. I also don't view people or animals or things as disposable. I was definitely having an avoidant attachment style and was obviously untrusting of somebody who was delaying a relationship over and over again and choosing other people over me over and over and over and over again, and who was not communicative. And I was a young person sowing my wild oats, but that was not allowed. He was allowed to do that. Yeah, that was fine. He was dating other women. I was letting him happen. He was dating Leah. I knew he had a thing for Leah. I talked to him about it. And I said it was fine. And I was fine with it. What I was not fine with was the lying and pretending it's not happening. And pretending that you're not, like, doing little mind games and shit. Like, what kind of person at their parents' house talks to another woman that's not your girlfriend and has them show and tell, like, lingerie in front of your sisters and your dad or whatever? Like, it was just too weird. Like, there was just so many boundary violations, and you need to be aware of boundary violations. It helps protect everybody. You know, just, like, let it go. The reason I let it go was because I had been in a polyamorous relationship before then. I don't really have jealousy in the same way that a lot of people do. And I really just want people to be, like, happy and do whatever is best for them. And I didn't think anybody needed to get hurt just because, you know, folks were young and still experimenting and learning about life and wanting different things or whatever. I really didn't think it needed to get that savage, but it did. It did. And I am reclaiming that part of my life. I'm getting some tattoos done. They're not going to be the same as what I wanted, but it's going to be a different riff on what I wanted. I decided to go and get ahead and get a different type of tattoo that I was going to get and was stolen from me. I decided to go ahead and get a dog. I went ahead and did that because I felt that I was ready. And had the resources and time to do the emotional work it was going to be required to deal with the extreme trauma that I went through. And I didn't even know. I just knew this at an intuitive level. But I would tell you, I got that dog, I started having to get therapy. And my therapist was like, well, you know, I started to feel it when Bear got to be 2 years old. And my fear of losing Bear is strong. And I'm trying to deal with it. You know? And, it stems from this. And the amount of emotions that came through my body was actually shocking to me. It was totally overwhelming. I find the whole process totally insane. And now I'm kind of past that part of it, I feel like. And I'm still kind of dealing with, like, the resentment and, like, bitterness and anger, which I, to be honest, I didn't really experience until way later, when I was kind of fully was able to truly face it and not disassociate, not compartmentalize, and face the fact that what I had described in these videos, that this was intentional. It was calculated. And I was completely misguided with, like, what I was thinking was happening, like, and that was, like, the hardest part, and I, as a mom, you know, leaving my baby with this guy, you know, and it's just hard, you know, like, that's kind of more what I'm dealing with now, is, like, I'm kind of getting, hopefully, done with the anger and resentment, and kind of moving into the more, like, rebuilding my self-esteem as a nurturer, basically, you know, as a good person, and, you know, I don't know if children are in the future. Maybe we'll have one, maybe we won't, but when I am ready, and when I get the bedroom remodeled, I will, there's a high likelihood that I will adopt. And if it's a family, then I will, if there's siblings, then I'll take all of them. And I am just, I'm building myself up. I'm not gonna cry. I'm building myself up to, excuse me, step into, one of the roles that, is important to me as a person, and as a woman.